The second half is finally here, quote unquote, the second half. Can the Guardians finish the job and win the division? And what trade targets are out there for them to bring in reinforcements?
You are Locked On Guardians, your daily podcast on the Cleveland Guardians. Part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the show. This episode of Locked On Guardians is brought to you by Booking.com. Booking.yeah, the right stay can make you a fan of any city, even your rivals. Check out Booking.com for your stay today. We have so much to dive in today, but first, I am Jeff Ellis, one of the original Locked On baseball hosts. Before that, I was a lead draft and prospect analyst at Scouting 24/7. And before that, I was your 75,000th favorite blogger at every Cleveland sports blog that has ever existed.
75,000 of them, probably, too. They've all been around. I'm Justin Ladd, your other co-host. I've been covering the Guardians minor league system since 2007. You've probably read me at places like Guardians Baseball Insider, the News Herald, the Morning Journal, and Prospects Live, and you've heard me here. All right, on today's show, will the Guardians finish the job? What are the biggest second-half storylines to look at? What do we think is the most important thing for the Guardians to kind of hold the second half in terms of what they did well? We already know what they need to improve. I don't think we need to sit here and have a whole discussion about what they need to improve. It's starting pitching. That's the obvious question.
Hitting as well, right? I mean,
offense, yeah, I mean, game. We'll talk about that. We'll talk about some trade targets out there. Jeff's going to do a blind ranking of pitching trade targets without knowing who's coming next. And we'll get into some more prospect talk at the end because we'll have to talk about who's going to go for these guys. We've also got some draft bonus news as well. So stick around for all that good stuff. Jeff, let's start with this. Will the Guardians finish the job in the second half? That's the biggest thing to ask. I've seen a couple places. There was like an Athletic piece that was running a model that was basically saying like the Twins are going to run them down. If you look at depth charts on Fangraphs, which is one of the things they're still good for over there, they still have the Guardians with a two-game edge over the Twins when it's all said and done. The Twins' offense is really good. Pablo Lopez has had some very bad luck when pitching. His FIP is way lower than his ERA. Their bullpen's been a little bit bad. I don't know if it'll get better or not. There's not a lot of bullpen options out there, as we were discussing off-air. But their offense has been pretty good. They're going to be coming hard. This is going to be a tight division until the end. I don't think there's going to be a lot of breathing room. So the Guardians are going to need a good second half. I don't think they can just afford to play 500 ball and coast the rest of the way. Although this says, Fangraphs depth chart says, if they go 33 and 34, they would edge the Twins by two games based on their projections.
Yeah, but I think the Twins are a little overrated offensively. When you look at...
Because Rice Lewis has never hurt healthy, yeah.
Well, I mean, Royce Lewis is the one guy who actually was performing below had some room for growth when you look at like indicator stats. Carlos Correa's got a 336 BABIP, Jose Miranda 349, Matt Waldner 389, 361 for Byron Buxton, 339 for Willie Castro. These are not sustainable numbers. Like, this is an offense that is, you know, not as good as it appears on paper. That might get me in trouble. Twins fans have been super prickly this year, but I mean, don't get me wrong. Are they better in Cleveland's? Absolutely.
This year,
they're better. the super prickly part. It's a prickly fan base. Let's just be honest about that. But, yeah, I think there's a lot of data that shows like they've had some bad ball luck. And listen, their pitching staff has as many questions as Cleveland does. Do you really trust? You know, Joe Ryan has been great. Pablo Lopez has been up and down. Listen, I've been driving the Bailey Ober bandwagon since that dude was at College of Charleston. Simeon Woods Richardson has been, you know, there's some positive signs there, I will admit. But yeah, this is just a team that, I mean, we really trust in Chris Paddock. I know he's been better, it's a guy who's been hurt a lot. Like, they have, again, like I said, I love Bailey Ober, but he's not gonna, he's a five, you know, they're rocking the same issues Cleveland is rocking. And Tanner's been better than Ryan. And, you know, when you look, he has been.
I guess. I don't know.
Joe Ryan's got 2.6 WAR. He's not right now. I believe Tanner is over a 3, isn't he?
I'd have to go look for sure. Either way, so, I think the Twins are still going to be a tough team to hold on.
I mean, no, absolutely. Don't get me wrong, but I don't think this is an open and shut case. Is I guess what I'm saying. Could the Twins chase him down? Absolutely, it could happen. But I mean, they've also got some, you know, bullpen issues of their own there too. It's going to be interesting to see how it shakes out to a degree. They could run him down. You know, they're dealing with their own sets. You know, remember when everyone told us Edward Julian was going to be the next big thing? You know, it takes time. You know, Jose Miranda last year, everyone told us to be the next big thing, and he's finally getting it together this year. They have interesting hitters. Who knows? Maybe Julian will come back and do what Miranda's done. Like, they'll have to figure it out. The nice thing is that for them is they have that hitter depth. But I think this is two teams that are close in talent, but Cleveland has had the upside in the head-to-head matchup, as well as they've built that lead. So even though the last few weeks were great, having that lead is a huge advantage. And, you know,
so
a team that's not been consistent at all.
What do we think the biggest thing is for the Guardians in the second half? Because obviously we know they got to trade for starting pitch, and that's a given. I don't think we need to spend a lot of time on that. But the other controllable pieces internally that they have, what do you think is a bigger need to keep up? Is there increased power? A bigger, like, does that need to hold up? Because I looked the other day, they went from 29th last year in pull percentage to third this year. So that seems pretty intentional. And what do they end up at power wise? They're 10th in home runs in the league or the majors. Is it more important for their power to hold up? Does this power surge to hold up? Or is it more important for their bullpen to do what they did in the first half? What do you think is the bigger key to the second half?
The bullpen, because the starting pitching is definitely the Achilles heel. So if the bullpen starts to regress, it's going to get ugly quick, because right now, you know, Tanner's been great and Ben Lively has been, you know, done a yeoman's job. He has really saved the day on this entire season. Gavin Williams has looked good. And then, you know, Carlos Carrasco seems to be getting better as the year goes on. Maybe I don't know how that works, but his last few starts, I feel like, have been some of his better ones. That fifth spot, you know, it's just, you know, Tristan McKenzie was awful. He's the worst starter in baseball. Logan Allen, by a lot of metrics, was the second worst. It's Spencer Howard was just poop show. Like, it's a situation where, and as much as I love, you know, like what Ben Lively has done this year, and it's great having Gavin Williams back, like, you're not going to press Williams to go late in games after missing half the year with an elbow issue. Ben Lively is a five and fly. Like, they need the bullpen. Because this is not a team that has starters who are going seven innings every day.
Yeah, I agree. The bullpen for sure, because you're not going to outslug teams. As good as their power increase has been, it's been important for them. And they've won games that way for sure. But this is a team that's built, I mean, always been built on pitching. And their bullpen has made it work when their starters have not been good. So I would agree. Their bullpen has to have another big second half in order for this to hold up and make it to the playoffs. We just hope that when they get to the playoffs, if they do finish the job, that they have some legs and arms left to stand on. Fill in this blank. I didn't put this on here, but fill in this blank, Jeff. This player needs the best second. The Guardians need this player to have the best second half. Which player does the Guardians need the most in the second half to have a big performance? Pitcher, hitter?
Part of me is tempted to say Gavin Williams just because of where it's been, or Logan Allen, because, like, getting him back to where he was. But there's this part of me in the back of my head that still says Bo Naylor. Because if Bo Naylor turns it on and turns it around and is who he was in the second half a year ago, who is arguably their best hitter in the second half, this lineup is completely changed. If Bo Naylor looks like the Bo Naylor he was and it's worth pointing out, like, he was terrible out of the gate last year. Like, for as bad as he's been this year, he was even worse as a rookie. It was ugly. So he is a super, super slow starter, maybe, if we're trying to find a positive. Because if he can do what he did, it's transformative. Because all of a sudden, if he's the best hitter in your lineup or close to that, when you already have Jose with Josh, hopefully staying healthy for the first time ever, with what Kwan being arguably the team MVP offensively, like, if you get Bo Naylor to that level, it's just going to have, because his defense has been good, right? So, like, more reasons to get him out there. Offensively, it'd be huge. So yeah, I think it's weirdly Bo Naylor, even though, like, I just spent all the time saying how key pitching is.
Yeah, because, I mean, you're going to hope for some reinforcements from pitching. So, I mean, Gavin Williams will be important, absolutely. Turning Logan Allen around will be important. I still think Tristan McKenzie, you're going to be able to go the second half without calling him back up. I think you're going to need him at some point, just the way things go. So hopefully they can turn him around as well. But I agree with you. I think it's both Naylors. I think they need Bo Naylor to have a huge second half, and they need Josh Naylor to have a huge second half too. So it makes Jose more imposing. Guardians only played 41 games in the first half at home. They will play 40 of their final 67 at home. So they played the majority of their games in the road in the first half. They are 30-11 at home. So hopefully some home cooking in the second half will be advantageous for them. When you're relying on your bullpen a lot to win games the way they have, you know, if you have to go to extra innings, you definitely want home field advantage. So, and hopefully they can clinch that for the playoffs too, because if the season ended today, they would be at home field advantage in a first round bye. We talked about reinforcements. We're going to talk about some of them in the second half. Jeff's going to blind rank some starting pitchers. We're going to talk about what prospects it would take to get them, and we'll get into some draft bonus news all on the way.
But first, let's talk about the good people over at booking.com. You know what I have to say. Booking.yeah. So booking.com, this show is brought to you by booking.com. Booking.yeah. It's heating up everywhere. I feel like if you are on the planet Earth, it's hot. It doesn't matter. You might be in the Arctic or Antarctic. Guess what? It's a sauna. Everywhere it's heating up, and you want to stay cool? Well, that's what booking.com can do. It can help you find the place to stay cool. It'll help you get there. They handle it all for you. Listen, we all like to be lazy. I love to be lazy. They have hotels, beds and breakfasts, vacation rentals, resorts, everything, and so much more at booking.com. You might find your perfect stay even in your rival's city. Justin talked about how it helped him go to the Hall of Fame, helped him find a great place to stay that avoided some of the hassle. From hotels that overlook stadiums, I've always said my dream is to go to Toronto and watch a game from that hotel. I don't know. That's something from my childhood that has intrigued me. So the right stay can make a fan of any U.S. city, even your rivals. Book today on booking.com, on the site, or in the booking.com app. And then additionally, I have to talk about Prize Picks. So I have it pulled up. It's the first time that it defaulted me to golf. So I'm going to move on from golf because I don't know about golf. I see COD. You can even do apparently Call of Duty. You know, there's so many different things. KBO baseball. Shoot, I can't give you much info. So let's do some MLB seasons. In terms of this, let's look at stolen bases for the year. We talked that Jose is at 10.5 left. I kind of want to go the over on Gunnar Henderson at 6.5. I feel like he should be stealing more bases in the second half. 22 for Ellie. I don't know if that's high or low. Otani at 11.5. I feel like you want to bet the under because are the Dodgers going to let him steal that many bases? You want a guy with a repaired shoulder trying to slide? No. If any of these seem good to you, head over to prizepicks.com or use the app. Use the code LOCKEDONMLB for a first deposit match up to $100. Again, that is code LOCKEDONMLB, all lowercase, all one word, for a first deposit match up to $100. Pick more, pick less. It's that easy. Justin, you might be muted.
Got the Lockdown Sports today on YouTube and on your Amazon Fire TV's app and channels for all local opinions on from people that know your teams the most. Forget the yelling, forget the screaming. Can't promise always good opinions. We can promise that, you know, these people know your team better than the national hosts do. So check out Lockdown Sports today on YouTube and on the Amazon Fire TV channels, apps, Lockdown Podcast, your team every day. Real quickly, want to mention too, earlier this week, Matt Boyd did have a rehab start in Arizona. That was Monday, I believe. He pitched 3 innings, struck out 7, allowed a run, and didn't walk anybody. So that was good. I was surprised to see he was already up to 3 innings, so he must be feeling pretty good. He's not in the 60-day IL, so that tells me that Cleveland thinks he'll be ready sooner than later, but they still said August just to be conservative on that. I don't blame them, so we'll keep track of how that goes. All right, Jeff, let's make some deals. You and I had a good, I don't know, hour-long conversation. Again, I feel like we have podcast conversations off the air that we might as well just record sometimes.
Yeah,
so people can kind of hear the
the debates.
All right. Yeah, the debates and just the information, and we'd have to watch our language.
Language.
Some of the things we're saying, but we do have like whole episodes off the air at some point. So let's rank the targets. Starting pitching is obviously the biggest need for the Guardians. So I'm not going to give you these in set order. So you're just going to have to rank these guys. And there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of them. So you're going to have to blind rank them without knowing who's coming next.
Okay.
So number one is the guy you talked about last night, Ross Stripling, who's been hurt this year. He's got an elbow issue, kind of concerns me, but he's been, you know,
he's got a good fit. He's got a good track record. Yeah, it doesn't walk anyone. You know, specifically talking with you yesterday, I was like, that might be a situation where, like, if you can get a better reliever, maybe you're trying to flip Barlow and a lesser piece for that, just so you can make salaries match. Like, I don't think he's the biggest one. So I'm going to put him at, like, I'll put him at 6. I'm intrigued just because he's got a history of being successful.
So Ross Stripling of Oakland at 6 out of 8. All right. Yusei Kikuchi, he's a rental from the Blue Jays. The Blue Jays there's already been rumors about the fact they're going to trade rentals at the very least. They are falling further out of it. They do seem like a likely seller, but again, they're only talking about guys that are free agents at the end of the year, and he is one of them, a lefty who might have some of the best stuff on this list I'm looking at.
In my head, he is not a second half pitcher. That could just be in my head, though. Still, when I think about like who's out there, and I'm pretty sure Fetty will come up. I don't know if Crochet will come up or not, just because like I don't think Cleveland's really in that part of the trading gene pool. I don't know if that's how I want to phrase that, but that's what came to mind. Jack, we could debate, but I'm going to put him 3. I'm just going to debate 3, and then I might get hosed depending on if you did put Crochet on this list.
Okay. Let's go back to the West. Let's talk about Tyler Anderson. He was 8. An all-star.
8.
that was that quick.
Huh? 8. Wow. His FIP and everything else is terrible. Like he is a tick. I told you he's a ticking Tom bomb. He's a ticking Tom bomb waiting to explode. I don't know what that is.
Might as well be a
ticking time bomb waiting to explode. It just,
all right. We talked about the Nationals quite a bit.
And he's going to cost more than Stripling to get him, probably. That's the other reason, too.
Which is crazy, yeah.
Anderson, Stripling, Anderson's probably better even as a ticking time bomb, but I think he's going to be more to get.
Let's go back to the East. We talked about this guy off the air yesterday. Really more of a kind of a Band-Aid more than a real fix, I guess. Trevor Williams from the Nationals. They're definitely sellers. They've already made one trade. And he's having the best year of his career this year, even though he barely throws 90.
I put him 4. Like, there's actually multiple guys who are kind of interesting with Washington. Like, I could do a 3-player deal from them and be happy. He's got a history of at least being a solid 5. Yeah, that fastball, you're lucky if it touches 90 miles an hour. But he's been able to be weirdly, he's been at some points really ineffective. But for most of his career, the reason that dude still has a career is because he has been weirdly effective with that. He's been able to be a 5. He is a Band-Aid, but is he better than Stripling and Anderson? Absolutely.
Yeah, I would agree. Definitely. I agree with where you have him behind Kikuchi. We'll see how the rest of this list shakes out. Old friend, Cal Quantrill. The Guardians got Cody Huff. If the Rockies are going to trade him, it's going to cost a lot more. Old friend, Cal Quantrill, who has basically one pitch at this point, but it's a good one.
Yeah. No, his splitter is fantastic, and he's throwing it more than he's ever thrown it, which is a big part of his success. Can I see the rankings right now? Yeah, thank you. I'm gonna put him at 5 because he's a multi-year guy, and he's probably gonna be expensive. His salary is gonna get more expensive, which is gonna make him a hard guy. I actually put him at 6. I'm gonna change that because you know he was $8 million last year. He's probably gonna be 12 next year. So you're getting a big salary guy who's, again, his underlying stats are not great. Teams are starting to figure out that all he can do is throw a splitter, and that splitter is fantastic. It might be the best splitter in baseball.
You had Quantrill. You had Stripling at 6, so.
Okay, then put him at 5. Then he can stay there. Okay. But he's going to cost a lot more than, say, Trevor Williams. And honestly, he's still been like a 4 this year. He's not been. And as teams maybe get used to the fact, it's like, yeah, this isn't the guy who was sinker ball all the time. He is now, you know, split a lot of the time. I think teams might be catching up because the data has not been as strong for him.
Paul Blackburn, another Athletic, who
seven
foot injury. I already told you had Stripling. It's
eight. I'm sorry. Eight. He's eight then.
Anderson. I'm sorry. No, you're right. Anderson's eight.
Yeah. Anderson's eight. So he's seven. Yeah. He hasn't been good this year. He's been hurt a lot. And like he's got multiple years of control. So he could get more expensive when you want the words more expensive with Paul Blackburn.
He's been hurt. He has a longer track record of doing what Ben Lively's doing this year. That's something I'll say. Eric Fetty, who has a year of control left, but he's in the division and doesn't have the track record of being successful. Also got to wonder, is he a guy that you, how do you feel about starting him in a playoff game? That's what the cost, you're basically getting into the cost of a guy who you'd have to start playoff game.
Compared to what they have, I'm okay with it. He's my one. It's 2 years of control at a team reasonable contract, a guy you can use. And you're like, but you just said you don't want Quantrell. I believe Fetty will make less than Quantrell will next year. I could be wrong in that, but I believe he will make less than Quantrell will make. And, you know, he's been a better pitcher this year. He's really had a strong year all around. And maybe I'm buying high and teams will figure him out. But right now he'd be one.
So that puts Jack Flaherty at number two. I actually agree with this list. I think Fetty makes the most sense for Cleveland. I have some reservations about him as a playoff starter. But again, when you're talking about what the rest of what the Guardians have right now, it's Bidey, it's Williams, it's Lively, and then it's either Fetty or you hope that when you've turned one of McKenzie or Logan Allen back around. So he's probably better than any at number four. He might even be better. He's probably better than Ben Lively. So I suppose this is better than the Cal Quantrill, Zach Plesac debate from a couple of years ago in the playoffs at the very least. So there's that. They're in a better spot with that. So I think Fetty makes the most sense, though. I think Cleveland might be looking at their rotation for next year and realizing they still need an option because you don't know what's going to happen with Shane Bieber, or you want to give yourself protection if you don't bring Shane Bieber back on a one plus deal. So Fetty makes the most sense in this list to me. If you're going for a rental, though, I think Kikuchi makes more sense than Flaherty just because.
Yeah, health.
Health, and I think you're going to pay a premium with Detroit. Fetty doesn't have the track record. Flaherty's a bigger name. I think other teams are going to go for Fetty. Is more of a solid option. We'll talk about some bats, talk about some relievers real quick in the last segment of the show, and we'll also talk about some more prospect banter as well as some draft signing bonus news. So all that good stuff ahead on a Friday edition of Locked On Guardians. Get supplies from the site that is made for skilled trades. SupplyHouse.com. SupplyHouse.com is the reliable way to order plumbing, HVAC, and electrical products online. They have the easy-to-use website that is packed with helpful resources and the latest production info to get the job done right. You can shop a complete inventory of over 200,000 parts and over 400 top brands to get your order delivered right to your door with fast shipping from coast to coast. If you need help with an order, you can get expert support and industry-leading service from the friendliest folks in the business. Talk to a real person every time. How frustrating is it when you call and you don't get a real person? Not at Supply House. Pros and skilled trades can get a competitive edge by joining SupplyHouse.com's free Trade Master program. Every Trade Master gets access to a dedicated phone line, free shipping, discounts on every order. Join the thousands of trade pros already benefiting from their free membership at SupplyHouse.com/TM and order plumbing, HVAC, and electrical supplies from anywhere with just a few clicks at SupplyHouse.com. Check out our friends over at FanDuel as well as the second half gets here. Baseball, everything's going to be heating up in the second half. Playoff races, win totals, awards, all that stuff to bet on right now. And, you know, you're going to have training camp coming up for the NFL. All that stuff is going to be in there to bet on. You can bet on futures, things like that. Even if it's in the middle of summer, I know the All-Star game's over. Hopefully you made some money on the Home Run Derby. Hopefully you didn't listen to me and take Jose Ramirez. But this summer, FanDuel is hooking up all customers and with a booster bonus daily. So there is something for everyone every day all summer long. Get in on the second half action. Put some money down on some awards. FanDuel, I'm sure Shohei Ohtani is running away with the awards. You can probably go through and put some money on division races because there's a lot of tight ones, including the AL Central. So head over to FanDuel.com. Start making the most out of your summer. FanDuel, official sports betting partner of Major League Baseball. Guardians are back in action at 6:40 on Friday against the San Diego Padres there in town. Hey, Jeff, it is Matt Waldron facing Tanner Bibee. How about that?
Like maybe the second best right player now. In the Clevenger deal now in terms of team value.
He might be. Yeah, he might be. So check out on your SiriusXM app. Just search Guardians to hear that one. I'll be there at that one. I'll be in person with some buds drinking some. I'm trying to do the 9-9-9 challenge on Friday. We'll see how it works. I've done it before, but it's been a while. All right, we talked some bats last night. We're not going to do a whole lot of rankings, but here's the bats we came up with. Number one, this list Jeff found, and I'm really intrigued here because we talked about how this team needs number five hitter behind Josh Naylor, I think is the biggest thing. I think they need someone who can really, you know, either make them fear Josh Naylor or make them regret not pitching him and putting him on base because teams like to pitch around him. Jesse Winker makes a ton of sense. This is a guy that Cleveland has been inquiring about for years, and he doesn't hit lefties well. He can't play the field, but he's the strong side of the platoon.
Yeah,
he hits right-handers well. It frees up David Fry to not play against righties, or you can move him around, use him as a pinch hitter. That's a perfect platoon to me, is David Fry and against lefties and Winker against righties, because Winker should not be – if you trade for Winker, you should basically just say leave your glove in Washington.
Yeah, and he's a guy that since his career started, you should be like, leave your glove. That was always my issue in Cincinnati. He's having a heck of a resurgence, and what makes him so ideal on top of the fact is, you know, we know this team is going to be cost conscious. He's only making $2 million. But if you go and you look at his Savant data, one thing that's constant is the dude doesn't chase. He doesn't chase out of the zone, and he also walks a lot. And we've talked about this team needs more guys who do that, more guys who work the count, more guys who get on base, and he has some pop too. So you put him with Fry, you might have a spectacular DH combination because we've seen what Fry can do against lefties. We know what Winker can do and what he's done this year. One of the top relievers, like I said, that's why I said there's three dudes. I wouldn't mind making a trade to get all three, and I don't think it'd be the most expensive for any of them because they're all rental types. Washington just got a nice, you know, and kind of nice. Like Caden Wallace is not a grand prospect. Just the Royals system was like, I think they were rated bottom five system coming into the year. Like that is a bad system. So I would argue the number one piece in that trade for Hunter Harvey, which is a year and a half of Harvey, was the draft pick, not the prospect. Mm-hmm. So there's some value there. Taylor Ward is a guy I've been on for forever. And I might say no to Jazz. You don't need to teach me about Jazz. He's hurt. You don't need a guy who's hurt.
Yeah, I don't think Jazz is a fit for this team. I know a lot of people might want him because he's a sexy name, but they're talking about moving him back to second base because the teams might want him at second base. That's not going to be a fit for Cleveland. And I don't know. Like I said, he's always hurt, and he's going to cost a ton of money. He's going to cost a ton in prospects. So it just doesn't seem worth it, especially for a team that's going to have a lot of middle infield options, and they've already got some options to sort through in center. Brent Rooker is also a popular name for a lot of people, but he's going to be 30, and
his data is unsustainable, and he's a DH. Like
he's also a DH.
And remember last year when everyone was losing their minds about Nolan Jones and Will Benson, and now how no one brings that up terrible. To us? Yeah, because and people are like, you know, BABIP doesn't matter. I'm like, yes, it does, and this is why. And you know who's got like nearly a 400 BABIP? Brent Rooker, or maybe it's like 340 or something like that. It's like, you know, his BABIP is in the unsustainable zone, and people who to just reset it, who don't know, it's batting average of balls put in play. It's been slowly moving up in the lower minus. It's a great indicator stat. You actually want guys to have high BABIP. It's a sign of quality contact, but around 290 to 300 is the typical range.
Faster guys 310.
Yeah. But guys who are way up here, like Nolan Jones was 400 last year. Like, like Luis Arise is the king of this. And I think he's like 340 most years. But it's just one of those things where that matters, and it matters a lot, and people can sometimes get mad about it. But yeah, it's just a fantastic indicator, and we know it. And Rooker, you're going to have to pay out the nose. So it's, I don't know, maybe Winker isn't as exciting as people want, but I think it's just, he's ideal. He gets on base.
He's a good fit.
He's an ideal fit. Though, depending on, I've heard personality conflicts with him in the past. That's the one.
Yeah, there has been that thing. But Cleveland's been interested in him before. So I have to imagine if they've been interested in him before, they feel maybe more confident about how he'd fit in here. So we'll see. And, you know, a lot of guys want to go to winning situations. So that also can change a player a little bit too. Taylor Ward's the only long-term option that makes sense on here because, you know, Canha's a free agent at the end of the year. Chisholm doesn't make sense. And Rooker's not a guy you want to be stuck with into his age, couple of 30 years, especially for what you're going to pay. So he's the only one that makes sense here. Let's look at relievers real quick. Could be a good twofer in Washington. You brought up Dylan Floro last night. Ground ball king.
He's really increased his sinker. Like if you're like, oh, he wasn't good a year ago. He like how Cal Quantrill is better because he started throwing a splitter significantly more. Florio's throwing the sinker and he's got the extreme ground ball rate and like no one is barrel. He's got the lowest barrel rate in baseball.
I don't want anything to do with Tanner Scott because he doesn't throw anything in the strike, anything near the strike zone. His walk rate's atrocious. He's the most popular reliever on the market. I don't want anything to do with him.
Chisholm doesn't like popular people.
Yeah, well, I'm not popular, so why would I? Always been jealous. Carlos Estevez is the guy I really want for the most part. The Angels are weird. He's having a great year as a free agent at the end of the year. He's a guy you can put in any situation. I know he's their closer because the Angels just need someone to close games, and he's the guy. But he's
been good in that role.
You can move him anywhere. We threw Chafin on the list because if the Tigers are going to trade Flaherty, they might as well trade Chafin because he's a free agent at the end of the year. He's got playoff experience. And then I threw Trevor Richards on the list from Toronto because he's also a free agent and they're willing to trade guys with 1 year control left. And he doesn't get righties out because he's a fastball changeup guy, but he's kind of like plus Eli Morgan. Like he's what Eli Morgan wants to be. He crushes lefties because of his changeup. And then we kind of talked about ourselves out of this one because it doesn't make sense, but the Reds are kind of in the middle right now. So I don't know where they're going to go. I would love to get Nick Martinez for Cleveland because he's a guy who can probably go two innings for you as long as he doesn't face the same batter twice. He's good, but he's a guy who can be a multi-inning reliever. So if you get into the situation in the regular season where a starter goes short, he's a guy you can throw for two innings any given day. But he makes too much money,
so
he's probably out. Yeah, and I think for me, Estevez makes the most sense on this list. Floro does too, and then maybe followed by Chafin.
Yeah, I just like Floro because I want Floro and Winker. That's just an ideal combo to me.
Yeah, you can get two for one there. And both of them are not going to cost a premium in terms of
my trade last night was maybe Gabby Arias and Parker Mezick for those two.
Yeah. The relief market somehow is even worse than the starting pitching market. Yeah. It's really wild. It's bad. We got
Yeah, go. You shoot it then. You do the.
All right. Well, you can talk about the there's a quick draft bonus accounting trick people should know about.
So this is what the Braves are doing. Like, my personal favorite, Luke Senard. If you go and you look, you're like, why did he sign for $2,500 under slot? Why that specific amount? Because there's an accounting trick. Whenever a player signs a contract, they get $2,500 as a contingency in case there's something wrong, I guess. And teams can choose whether or not that counts against the slot or not. So Senard got full slot, but the Braves essentially saved $2,500. Which means with 10 picks, they save $25,000 and they're still spending it. By saving it, that's money they can spend on another player. So that's money that will help them get Cam Caminiti because they spent a ton on Ethan Bagwell. You can only do it with day one and two picks. So Cleveland could have an additional $27,000. We'll have to wait and see. I don't think they've done that in the past, which is interesting because they typically use every other amount. And then they signed Caden Favors for a lot, for a senior.
$75K
is a lot. I would have
projected. The slot was 357.
I thought he'd get 30,000. Like a few years ago, Adam Scott was considered a ton as a senior sign, and that was 50,000. So they really like Favors. This is a sign that he had a lot more value than we were giving him. But it also means that, like, I thought they had about 180,000 in wiggle room on my initial estimates. Now knock that down by 45,000 so that they have, 135,000 in wiggle room. So again, everyone on day three is getting max 150K. I think is a takeaway from that. Yeah,
definitely.
And if they use the trick,
paying the overage,
then that would be an additional, 160,000 essentially.
Yeah, definitely a sign they'll be paying the overage at the end,
which they always do.
But we were kind of wondering if they would do it this year with 18 million to spend. The other thing to note here too is Chase Burns got 9.23, so he barely edges out Paul Skeens, 9.25. He edges out Paul Skeens from a year ago by 500,000. I think Bazana is going to be really close. It's going to be either under or just barely over that.
I'm kind of shocked that he got that much because, like, yeah, I get it. It's a year later, but he's not as good as Skeens was. And for the Reds, especially if it makes me wonder how much, it makes me wonder how much Condon is, because we all thought Condon would be 9.5. Was Condon 9.7? Like, how much is Condon?
Because
200,000 for me is not a good enough reason to do a haircut there. It was a top two player class. You take one of the top two players, 200,000 should not affect it. So I can't wait to see some of these other signings.
Yeah. We'll revisit trades next week as well. We'll talk more prospect rankings, of course, and we'll talk about how the Guardians look coming out of the All-Star break. Hopefully it's good. Hopefully the rest helped them.
Yeah, it's going to be fantastic. We know. Like, this is the team of destiny, right? Remember to rate and review. Download daily. It helps. We hit 3,000. The push for 4 begins. So get us on the train to 4,000. Thank you all for joining us. Rate and review. Download. That helps. And go, go, Guardians, go.